Welcome to the second review of Space and Astronomy News, selected for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel. The news, which will be weekly, will try to provide a quick overview of everything interesting that's happened in recent days in the field of astronomical research and space exploration. Astronews, recent space news and discoveries, March 2021. One. Hey guys, are any of you old enough to remember that? It was the brightest supernova in nearly 400 years when it lit the skies of the Southern Hemisphere in February of 1987. Supernova 1987A, the explosion of a blue supergiant star in the nearby mini-galaxy known as the Large Magellanic Cloud, amazed the astronomical community. It offered them an unprecedented opportunity to observe an exploding star in real time with modern instruments and telescopes. But something was missing. After the supernova faded, astronomers expected to find a neutron star, a hyperdense collapsed stellar core made largely of neutrons, left over at the heart of the explosion. They saw nothing. In the 34 years since, astronomers have been searching, unsuccessfully, for the missing neutron star. Various theories arose. Perhaps it hadn't had time to form yet, or perhaps the blue supergiant's mass was larger than expected, and the supernova created a black hole instead of a neutron star. Perhaps the neutron star was hidden, obscured by dust from the explosion. If the missing star was there at all, it was really hard to see. But persistence paid off. Astronomers may have finally found it. The first hint came from the Atacama Large Magellanic Submillimeter Array, ALMA, in Chile last summer. The radio telescope observed a hot blob within the core of the supernova. The blob itself is not a neutron star, but rather a heated mass of dust and gas, which may hide the neutron star behind it. After all, something is providing the heat. But to confirm the presence of a neutron star would require further observations. With ALMA's promising radio signals results in hand, a team of researchers followed up by observing the supernova in X-ray wavelengths, using data from two different NASA spacecraft, and their results are being published in the Astrophysical Journal this month. What they found is an X-ray emission near the core of the supernova explosion, and that led them to think that it might be the emission of a pulsar. Pulsars are a type of energetic neutron star that rotate rapidly, flashing radiation outwards like a lighthouse as they spin. Pulsars can sometimes create high-speed winds which blow outwards and create nebulae, shaped by charged particles and magnetic fields. This is what the researchers think they are seeing. Somewhere within the center of supernova 1987A lies a young pulsar. It may be a decade or more before the core of the supernova clears out enough to observe the pulsar directly, but for the first time in 30 years, astronomers can be fairly confident that it is there. The discovery is exciting. Being able to watch a pulsar essentially since its birth would be unprecedented. It might be a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to study the development of a baby pulsar. So with a 30-year-old mystery solved and plenty of new science to do in the years and decades ahead, supernova 1987A promises to keep our attention. After all, it's the closest and brightest supernova we'll ever see, unless Betelgeuse explodes. 2. Good news, don't you think? With the discovery of the missing pulsar, we are perhaps about to solve one of the most exciting mysteries of the last decades. But also the one I am about to propose is not bad. Apparently, the time has come to forget forever the old story that wanted Phobos and Deimos to be two asteroids captured from the Red Planet. Listen up. Ever since they were discovered in 1877, the moons of Mars, Phobos and Deimos, have raised many questions, some of which remain open to this day. Of these two objects, in fact, the surprise, among other things, are the small size. Just 22 kilometers in diameter for Phobos and about 15 for Deimos, and a regular shape. The main question to which astronomers are struggling to find an answer, and on which depend also other open questions, however, is what is their origin? A new research of the Institute of Geophysics of the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich, published in Nature, seems to give a better answer than many so far proposed. For some time, it has been hypothesized that Phobos and Deimos, because of their small size and morphological characteristics, could actually be asteroids captured by the gravitational force of Mars. The weakness of this hypothesis lies in the fact that the orbits of the two satellites are almost circular. and moreover lie on the equatorial plane of the planet. If the two moons were two captured objects, their respective orbits would have been more eccentric and quite different from each other. This means that the two objects must have had a common origin and certainly associated with the formation of the planet. Now a new study proposes an alternative hypothesis. Phobos and Deimos would be formed by fragmentation of a larger moon following a violent impact. The authors of this study started from the weaknesses of previous hypotheses and focused on recent data on the consumption of the two moons, which are very porous. With these bases, scientists have tried to reconstruct, through computer simulations, the history of the two satellites, going back in time. It came out that the hypothesis that the orbits of the two moons at one time intersected. More precisely, the hypothesis argues that orbiting Mars, there was only one large satellite, which at some point suffered an impact that caused the disintegration. From the debris produced would be formed Phobos and Deimos, and all of this would have happened over a period ranging from 1 to 2.7 billion years ago. According to this research, the original moon would have been at a much greater distance than that at which the two satellites are today. And it is also worth remembering that today Phobos is getting closer and closer to Mars, with the result that in about 40 million years it could end up impacting the planet or be broken up by Mars's tidal forces once it gets too close. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. 3. Let's talk now of a study according to which it was a comet fragment to lead to the death of the dinosaurs, and also another one published that instead confirms with new evidence that it was surely an asteroid to cause the destruction, and with this excluding once and for all the theory of volcanic eruptions. In short, we see this time in a definitive way the most credited hypothesis since the 80s, when scientists found everywhere in the world traces of iridium in the same geological layer where dinosaur fossils were found. The discovery of this uniform layer of dust from an extraterrestrial body has given scientists an apocalyptic image of that period, whose atmosphere was characterized by a dense dust that prevented solar heat to reach the Earth to warm it and to feed life through photosynthesis. The impact was, in short, the beginning of a planetary winter that killed most of the living species. The dust then spread again like a sheet over the Earth. In the 90s, the relationship between the Cretaceous extinction and cosmic impact was further confirmed by the discovery of the Chicxulub Crater in the Mexican Yucatan Peninsula, also dated to the end of the Cretaceous period. According to the new study now published in Science Advances, we have finally found the missing link. That same asteroid dust found in several parts of the world was also found inside the Chicxulub Crater, in the precise geological position that marks the time of extinction. 4. Kinda like Venus, Titan's surface is also undetectable from outer space. In this case, Saturn's large moon appears to be permanently immersed in a thick fog of nitrogen gas, but below the clouds, the landscape looks familiar to Earth, with mountains, continents, islands, rivers, lakes, and seas in a liquid state. But similar does not mean equal. Titan is in fact a hostile and cold world. Its distance from the Sun is about 10 times that of the Earth, and its surface temperatures are around minus 180 degrees Celsius. Even the hydrological cycle on Titan works in a way similar to that of our Earth, but also in this case with a not insignificant difference. Instead of water, Saturn's moon hosts liquid methane and ethane, so much so that its surface appears dotted with hundreds of lakes and seas of hydrocarbons. The largest of these seas, the Kraken Mare, is as large as our Caspian Sea, 400,000 square kilometers, and contains about 80% of the surface liquids of the satellite. Well, in the course of a new study, scientists have managed to estimate the depth, finding that in some places comes up with over 300 meters. All thanks to the Cassini probe, which during one of its close passes in August of 2014, managed to send a radar pulse that was reflected first from the sea surface and then from the seabed. By measuring the delay between the two signals, scientists have now been able to measure the depth and determine that the liquid is composed of 70% methane, 16% nitrogen, and 14% ethane. The question at this point might be, but is it really that important to know the depth of a pool of liquid that is on a moon so far away? Well, you should first of all know that NASA is already planning to send a mission to explore Titan's seas within the next 20 years. So it is absolutely necessary to know in advance the environmental conditions in which the probe called Titan submarine will operate. Among other things, there are ongoing projects to recreate in the laboratory conditions similar to those present on Saturn's satellite. One of the reasons why the results of this study will help engineers to outline the characteristics of the submarine, which will probably have a length of 6 meters. 5. The path back to the Moon is made up of stages. In addition to the first human mission of the Artemis era, there is another ambitious project that is taking shape in parallel, the Lunar Gateway. As mentioned on other occasions, this is a permanent outpost that will allow for an orbiting base around the Moon. According to the projects, this lunar portal should be about 1/6 the size of the International Space Station and able to accommodate men and goods in transit to the Moon. To do this, however, will require a lot of money and cutting-edge technical solutions. What's new is that NASA recently announced that 2 station modules will be launched aboard Elon Musk's SpaceX Falcon Heavy. In the announcement, NASA said it selected Falcon Heavy to successfully carry the 2 modules named Power and Propulsion Element and Habitation and Logistics Output into orbit. These are 2 fundamental units of the future Lunar Gateway, with dimensions that do not allow the use of smaller launchers. NASA technicians have in fact discovered that SpaceX's Falcon Heavy rocket should be able to complete the mission in a single launch, ensuring a significant cost savings. A rightful thing, considering that the single trip will still cost the federal coffers $331.8 million. According to reports, the timing would provide for a launch of the modules already assembled on Earth, not before May of 2024. In the same year, there should be, according to the official roadmap, the landing of human beings on the Moon with the Artemis 3 mission. The Power and Propulsion Element module will provide electrical energy through solar panels and will allow the station to vary its speed and altitude, while the Habitation and Logistics Output, 55 cubic meters of living space, will be the actual living module where the astronauts will be able to live and where there will be the docking part for the capsules and landers. With these 2 modules, the Lunar Gateway will be able to remain autonomously in orbit around the Moon to perform the docking with the Orion capsule and host astronauts for short stays. The Artemis 3 mission will be the first mission that will descend onto the lunar surface. Okay guys, we're done for this week. What do you think? What news struck you the most?